It's been 6 months since I bought a Home Assistant Green, a mini server that runs the open source smart home platform Home Assistant. And while I've definitely had my periods of frustration with Home Assistant, it has proven to be a powerful smart home platform that can do more than most of the other smart home platforms I've used, and it's incredibly flexible. To me, the number one feature of Home Assistant Green has actually been its price. It costs just $99, which puts it in splurge territory for many people who have been curious about Home Assistant and interested in a locally controlled private smart home hub. It's basically a cheaper version of Home Assistant Yellow, which comes with a Zigbee chip integrated into it, but often doesn't come with a Raspberry Pi compute module, which you'll need to install Home Assistant on first, and it doubles the cost compared to Home Assistant Green. Home Assistant Green does include two open USB-A ports at the back, so you can install plug-and-play modules like Home Assistant Sky Connect, which allows Home Assistant Green to connect directly to Zigbee, Matter, and Thread devices. Another major benefit of Home Assistant is it all runs locally, so it's not cloud-based by default, though there are ways that you can connect it to the cloud. This gives you several advantages, like better privacy for your smart home data, automations will run quicker, and then you'll be less impacted by outages. Home Assistant's third advantage is it's open source, and that means that its code base isn't just coming from one company, but a community of contributors around the world. And just recently, it was announced that Home Assistant will now be run through the Open Home Foundation, a newly formed nonprofit organization. This makes Home Assistant quite unique compared to its competition, like Samsung SmartThings, Amazon, Google, Apple, Homey. All of those companies are run for profit. The incentives for Home Assistant are just different. They're not trying to make money by selling you expensive hardware, or collecting your data, or having their assistant constantly ask you if you want to reorder things you already have. It's promising to see the Open Home Foundation focusing in these areas, because if smart home technology is really to take off for everyone, these areas are critical to avoiding the pitfalls of a lot of the smart home tech around today that alienates a lot of users. Moving on, another highlight with Home Assistant Green was actually setting it up. It was simple, though the installation can take up to 20 minutes to finish running. It was a bit confusing trying to figure out when it was actually done because it didn't auto-fresh for me. I needed to actually manually tap refresh to see that the installation had completed. Once the initial setup is complete, you'll be able to add your existing or new devices to Home Assistant. Some of these devices will automatically be identified, while others, like my Roborock vacuum for example, I had to manually add. Setting up Zigbee devices using the Sky Connect dongle was pretty easy. I was sent the Sky Connect and a few zone-off Zigbee devices from Ameridroid at no cost to test out. And the experience was pretty simple once I figured it out, which is a phrase that perfectly describes most of my experiences with Home Assistant right now. It was easy for me to miss the text at the bottom of the card that came with the Sky Connect, but those setup instructions are actually pretty critical. I added the Zigbee integration, followed the steps to set up my Zigbee network, and then selected Add Devices from this device to have it look for new Zigbee devices. Then I just took my Sonoff smart plug, held down its button for 5 seconds to put it into pairing mode, and then boom, it showed up and I was able to pair it to Home Assistant, all without giving another company my email address to set up an account. Now, the idea I had for this switch was to fix a problem I have with my printer. It just stopped showing up for Apple devices after a certain amount of time, and the only way I found to reliably fix that issue is to just turn it off and turn it back on again. And because Home Assistant has both a HomeKit bridge and HomeKit device integration, you're easily able to add Home Assistant devices to HomeKit or HomeKit devices to Home Assistant. So I created the bridge, selected the printer switch, added it to HomeKit via the QR code, and boom, it showed up in my Apple Home app. Then I created a shortcut that'll turn the printer off for 5 seconds and then turn it back on again. And because shortcuts work with Siri by default, when I ask Siri to toggle the printer, it just does it. This scenario really shows you how powerful and flexible Home Assistant can be for automating parts of your home exactly the way you want, bringing together multiple device types, protocols, and even platforms. You can find the documentation I used to set up things like Sky Connect linked in the blog post for this review, which I'll leave down in the description. And speaking of automation, one thing I've come to really rely on in my smart home is automated fans, and this video's sponsor DREO has a pretty cool one. With its cutting-edge, hyper-powerful airflow, the DREO Smart Omnidirectional Polyfan revolutionizes whole home air circulation. Its air booster structure concentrates incoming air into a far-reaching jet that can ventilate spaces up to 80 feet away. It has an impressive omnidirectional oscillation with 120 degrees vertical and 120 degrees horizontal rotation to ensure fresh airflow reaches every room corner, no more stale air pockets. Despite its impressive power, the Polyfan operates at an ultra-quiet 23 decibels thanks to its owl wing-inspired blade design, significantly reducing air resistance noise. What really makes the Polyfan smart, though, is its app control and monitoring capabilities. You can effortlessly adjust the fan modes, angles, schedules, and more from anywhere. You can even keep an eye on your room temperature, plus it comes with a remote control, eliminating the need for manual adjustments. With its unmatched air circulation power, quiet operation, and smart app control, the DREO Polyfan is the ultimate whole room air cooling solution. So, if you want to upgrade to a cooler room and help support our channel, click the link in the description and get your own DREO Polyfan today. Home Assistant supports a ton of different types of automation, and they're more advanced than most other smart home platforms. And better yet, Home Assistant will actually allow you to automate entities, which are the building blocks of Home Assistant and your home data, and act differently from how Home Assistant treats single devices. For example, if you have a motion sensor that also has a temperature and light sensor integrated into it, the motion sensor will show up in Home Assistant as one device, but it will contain three separate entities. This way, you could build an automation just off the light sensor while ignoring motion. Another big highlight of Home Assistant is the dashboards. By default, every device you add to Home Assistant shows up in the main overview dashboard. But the cool thing with Home Assistant is you can customize your dashboard view, create multiple dashboards, and for some devices, even change the design of the card on the dashboard. For example, I customized a dashboard that I pull up on my Pixel tablet that's specific to the room it's in, making it a bit easier to get to the devices in that particular room. The last main benefit of Home Assistant Green is how many integrations you can actually do with Home Assistant, thanks to it being one of the largest open source projects in existence. Even if you have a device that doesn't have a natively supported integration with Home Assistant, it's likely somebody has hacked a way together to actually bring it into your Home Assistant instance. As long as you're able to commit the time and follow a bunch of steps to get it working. Integrating my Google Nest and Ecobee devices involved quite a few steps, creating developer accounts and a lot of other roundabout ways to get those devices integrated into Home Assistant. And that's probably the largest downside to Home Assistant Green and Home Assistant in general. It can take a lot of time to work on, depending on the non-native devices you're trying to integrate with it and the automation you're trying to set up. There's also no option to enable automatic Home Assistant updates natively, so you'll need to log in and manually update the software occasionally. This takes less than 5 minutes, so it's not really a time suck, it's just another chore you'll need to remember to do. Another downside I've run into with Home Assistant is even if you're successful with integrating a device, often that device's functionality is limited. For example, while Philips Hue actually has a pretty good integration with Home Assistant, it's still way easier to go into the Philips Hue app to program certain settings, especially for accessories like my light switches. Or for my Roborock S8 Max V I've been reviewing, the Roborock integration allows you to do basic things, but for more complicated actions like sending it to multiple rooms or telling the robot to vacuum the front hall, for that, you need to do some scripting and some automations and potentially adjust some cards in your dashboards to set things up the way you want. This is actually a great example of how flexible using Home Assistant Green can be, but you do need to devote the time to be able to do it. Another slight downside with Home Assistant Green is just aesthetics. It's a pretty basic, techie-looking server. It's not something you'll necessarily want to have out on a table, in the same way a Homey Pro was designed, for example. Though Home Assistant Green by default doesn't have things like an IR blaster, so you can get away with just tucking it into a cabinet like I did, and you can thankfully turn off all the LEDs at the front in hardware settings for the device via Home Assistant. Another big downside of Home Assistant is currently there's no plug-and-play hardware for voice control, though thankfully that is coming later in 2024. For now, the only Home Assistant voice control you can use is via the app, which works pretty well. You can also buy a third-party kit for $13 and install software on it to run the voice control, but again, you'll have to devote some time to setting that up. Now, could you just add your Home Assistant devices to the Amazon Assistant or the Google Assistant? Yes, but you'll need to pay for Nabu Casa's Home Assistant Cloud service, which allows you to connect your Home Assistant instance to the two assistants in a few clicks. Or you'd need to do it manually, which is way more involved and time-consuming. For Siri, you can use shortcuts to trigger Home Assistant Assist. There's already a shortcut you can use in Home Assistant's documentation, but you can also do things like create shortcuts for your Home Assistant automations, like the ones I created for my Roborock automations. So those are all the downsides I've encountered. Now let's talk recommendations. Do I recommend Home Assistant Green? Yes, absolutely. But it is a device I think is mainly for two types of users right now. The first type is like me, where you may already have smart home tech in your home, but you want to expand into more things or want to control more of it locally or expand it with Zigbee devices. You can pretty much figure things out on your own, but you don't want to spend a ton of time having to follow a million steps to try to get everything integrated into Home Assistant. You're mainly going to use Home Assistant Green to offload what you can to run locally and then keep your other smart home tech as is. The second type of person I think Home Assistant Green is for is what I'll call the advanced user. Maybe a software developer or someone with deep technical knowledge who likes to tinker and wants a starting point to get into Home Assistant, but doesn't necessarily need an integrated Zigbee radio right away. This person might make use of the scripts you can build with Home Assistant, edit the YAML code directly, or even consider contributing to the Home Assistant codebase by joining the open source community. The only user I don't think Home Assistant Green is for right now is the casual smart home user that just wants to buy plug-and-play smart home devices, bring them home, set them up, add them to the platform, and then never really have to think about the setup again. Home Assistant just isn't quite there for that user yet. Home Assistant is transitioning from a smaller niche player to a major one. They're working on bringing in new plug-and-play voice control hardware and improving the UI to make it simpler and easier for everyone in the home to use. They're also building out a Works With program, similar to the ones you've already seen. If those working on Home Assistant can actually do all of this, I think in the not-too-distant future, it might just be the best solution for people to automate and run their smart homes. Home Assistant Green retails for $99, and I've left links in the description to it and all of the accessories that you saw in this video, like Sky Connect, if you want to check their current prices and learn more. If you're interested in more smart home devices and platforms like the Homey Pro that I'd mentioned earlier, you can get to my review of it by clicking the card here. And for all of my other reviews and videos on smart home devices, you can see all of them by clicking on the playlist here. Don't forget to hit that thumbs up button below if you like this video and subscribe to the channel for more smart home videos like this one. For 6 months later, I'm Josh Tedder. Thanks for watching.